Hey guys, Zack Marsh here, and this is my review of Gravity Falls. So ending off day 3 is Dipper versus Manliness, an episode that, being perfectly honest, is one that Alex Hirsch himself admitted he didn't particularly care for when he was working on it. Like, essentially it was one of those things where it was like, he thought he messed up the tone of the show with it because he didn't think, because the idea of monsters being out in broad daylight and being, because when he was trying to, you know, create these urban mystery cryptid legends show was... Honestly, when he got a little too stuck in his head when he was working on it and was worried about it for that reason. But then also, because there was more modern, like, sensibilities and stuff like that were coming up, you know, the LGBTQ community and those kinds of things, he started to become concerned that the episode itself didn't age particularly well. And there was a, and it got to the point where he wanted to have the episode pulled entirely, but he wound up releasing it anyway. He and the team wound up releasing it anyway. And ultimately, it is, he looking back on it, he now admits that, and this is what I kind of take away from it as well, is that it's just a really good episode on the idea of toxic masculinity, which is essentially what the entire episode boils down to. It is this, you know, of the idea that, you know, you have to be a man in a certain way, being this macho man, which obviously is not how what being a man is actually about, but of course, it does, and that kind of is set up with Dipper's little arc. Mabel has an arc. Mabel and Stan have an arc too, but it's not as important. But in any case, establishing this, the episode opens up with Stan showing off the gift shop to Tyler Kupiker, who is apparently there trying to do his Christmas shopping, even though it's the middle of, I want to say, June or July. You know, it's like the middle, I want to say it's the middle of June, because that makes sense timeline-wise for me in my head. But of course, it's the middle of June. He's trying to do his Christmas shopping, and we find out that he's very excitable. Like if his character wasn't established firmly before this, it's like, oh, show up, get him. He's established to be a very excitable and also very energetic, which, you know, makes him a really fun character. But of course, Stan is trying to, you know, get him to buy something and leave. At which point, Dipper and Mabel walk in claiming that they're hungry and that they want to go to the diner. Also making this really cute thing where they bang their stomachs together. But of course, Stan points out that he'll happily take them to the diner as soon as, you know, Tyler makes up his mind. But then ultimately decides that, you know, he's fine with locking Tyler in if they are, because he's not really going very quickly. So they proceed to do that, and so he doesn't really realize that they've left. He's currently agonizing over whether to buy a Puma shirt or a Panther shirt, which, you know, is just fun because they're pretty much the exact same shirt. But ultimately, they go to the diner where Stan immediately sits down, and he starts. We met Lazy Susan previously, but we were introduced here as, you know, the person who's running the diner. And of course, she of course is introduced as, you know, Stan's sort of love interest. Like, he immediately sits down and starts flirting with her, which of course she kind of is amused by. He asks her where she was yesterday. She responds that she got hit by a bus, which they just both kind of play off as a joke. But Stan asks them if they do split plates in Greasy's diner. Which of course she points out that, yeah, they do. So she points out that she'll have to take a fourth portion. She'll give everybody until the kids will have ketchup and mustard, which of course they aren't particularly enthused about. And with Mabel, of course, pointing out that she wants pancakes. But of course, Stan remarks that he can't afford pancakes with the fancy flour that's in them, claiming that he's not made of money. Of course, he accidentally reveals that, you know, he's got money tucked up, coming out of his sleeves, so he immediately tucks it inside. At which point, Dipper, trying to figure out, starts eyeing a manliness tester, discovering that it will give out free pancakes if he's able to win it. at which point he declares that, you know, pancakes are on him as he's going to try and win the manliness test. Which, of course, they point out that he is not going to be able to do, pointing out that he's not exactly... they kind of have a laugh at his expense, but they point out that he's not exactly manly. Kind of pointing out that, you know, the obvious thing that Stan points out that, you know, he smells like baby wipes. He smells like baby wipes, has smooth, unclean skin. And then also points out that there was, you know, last week's quote-unquote incident. At which point we find out that he actually listens to Icelandic pop group ABBA and also knows the lyrics to all the lyrics to one of their songs. Which of course may differ is kind of embarrassed about, but undeterred, he does decide to go and walk over to the manliness tester. And we also see a bunch of people hanging out in the diner as well. It's kind of implied here that Wendy and Manly Gan are related. Like, it's implied that he is her father, because, you know, they're eating at the diner together. And then obviously, you know, we find out that Deputy Derlin and Sheriff Loves are screwing around as usual. Ultimately, Dipper makes his way over to the manliness tester. And obviously everybody turns their attention to Dipper because they're like, oh, is he actually going to do it and win the pancakes? But he walks over to the manliness tester, and unsurprisingly, he can't do it. He winds up seemingly doing well at first before ultimately getting the worst possible score on it. Which, of course, he claims that it's just broken and that it's not really, that's probably run out of steam power or whatever it requires to power it. But it's this point where Manly Dan walks over, shoves Dipper out of the way, and then immediately demonstrates that no, it's not broken, Dipper's just not strong enough to do it. So yeah, he immediately kind of emasculates Dipper accidentally by just demonstrating his ability to turn on the mechanism with his pinky. So, and then of course Manly Dan declaring that free pancakes for everybody, and everybody is very much starts cheering Manly Dan, which of course causes Dipper to kind of run out of the diner embarrassed, because he's not really, you know, feeling the best about himself right now. But of course, Stan just remarks that he can't believe that he's related to Dipper. But of course, and Mabel just points out that he's gotta have some sort of soft spot. Like, it's Stan. Like, Stan has to have something that he likes. But of course, Stan. It's at this point where Stan rebuts that he doesn't. But then Lazy Susan walks over with their food, and Stan is visibly flustered when he tries to talk to Lazy Susan, and of course this causes Mabel to finally put two and two together and discover that actually Stan does secretly have a thing for Lazy Susan, which of course Stan immediately admits to just to shut her up, and admits that yes, he does have a crush on her, but also admits that he's not entirely sure how to actually get her to talk to him, pointing out that, you know, he's been out of the game for a long time, and she's a very classy woman. Of course she's not. She works in a diner, she has a lazy eye, and she's banging on a pie trolley to try and get it to spin. But of course Mabel points out that she is definitely going to help, that if Stan is worried about, you know, the idea that he's not good enough for Lazy Susan, then he will help him become a better man. So that he can actually be stand a chance with her. So, which of course he's pointing out that they have the power of Mabel, with Stan thinking that it's gonna be love, but no, it's Mabel. So, at which point the episode kind of breaks up into an A story and a B story. I'm gonna kind of intersperse them in between each other, but the A story and the B story are kind of happen alongside one another and also intersect at various points. But the A story, of course, is that Dipper, you know, goes off on his own. He's not feeling super great about himself. He feels emasculated, but because of what happened in the diner. But making matters worse, first and foremost, he sees a fire hydrant break when Sheriff Bloves and Deputy Derlin kind of investigating, pointing out that it's a mystery and they have no idea what happened to it. Which winds up being connected to a point later in the episode. But this is this point where Derlin asks if they should take off their uniforms and run around it. Which, of course, Blubbs just responds, "Quit beating my mind." And, of course, they're very visibly, you know, more masculine than Dipper. So, having, you know, proper Chester and those kind of things. So, and being kind of unashamed of their bodies. So, he's not feeling super great about his own. And of course, he doesn't have chest hair. That's another point the episode brings up. But it was at this point where he runs into a woman who was looking for the mailman, and he proceeds to go off on this long rant about how he's clearly not man enough for her or anything else. And she, of course, just points out if he's okay, because that's not what she was talking about. She was looking for someone to deliver her mail. But of course, he just kind of runs off crying, just kind of tearing up. At which point, he runs into the woods and starts doing sit-ups to try and, you know, grow some chest hair or grow some muscle. But of course, starts to wonder that maybe he doesn't have what it takes, wondering if it's some sort of physical block between in his brain or if it's some psychological. He's not entirely sure. But then he pulls out a bag of jerky, with the wrapper telling him he's inadequate, and he responds that you said it and he needs help. At which point, he hears a loud slam stomping noise coming from deep within the forest. At which point, a bunch of animals and Manly Dan run out, with Manly Dan telling Skipper that something is coming and he needs to run. And of course, this brings up the idea of what could possibly scare Manly Dan that badly. Because, you know, it's Manly Dan, the most macho man guy in town. So this, of course, brings up the idea that it's probably something to be scared of. And sure enough, this monster suddenly appears. And it's clearly some sort of man monster thing, which, of course, causes Dipper to become very confused. But it's, of course, immediately finds Dipper and also scratches its back with a deer. But it does ultimately find Dipper, and Dipper, believing he's done for, starts to cower before the monster declares that it just wants the bag of jerky that he has. And of course, Dipper, realizing that the monster is friendly, does ask it what it does, starts to analyze that it is some sort of half-man, half-beast type thing, and asks it if it's some sort of minotaur. And of course, the monster reveals itself to be a manitor, which is half-man, half-tor. He doesn't fully understand, he's not really, you know, smart enough to figure out that, you know, he's half-man, half-tor, half-bull. But, of course, eventually, he does smell, Zipper's unpromised emotional issues. Even Dipper's a little confused as to why he's there, but the manitor just responds that he was summoned by the smell of beef jerky. But now that he's met Dipper and is sensing his emotional issues, he does decide to hear Dipper out and let him talk out his feelings and all these other things. And of course, Dipper does lay out all the cards on the table about how he, you know, his uncle doesn't think he's manly enough. He obviously flunked out his manchester thing, and he obviously doesn't have any chest hair, which of course the manitor does kind of point out that, you know, are all valid reasons to be upset. And Dipper then asks if it's clearly noting the, you know, very masculine build of the creature, does ask him if it could help him out. And of course, the manitor responds that yeah, he can, and then proceeds to have Dipper climb on his back hair, which obviously is established to be very gross, and Dipper is initially reluctant to do it, but he does. And then, which point, the manitor with Dipper on his back proceeds to race through the forest. Dipper hits his head on every branch, by the way, as a comedic gag. But eventually they arrive at a cliff face, which Dipper thinks they're going to run into, but then the manitor runs through it to reveal his home. Of course, he then proceeds to explain that the gnomes live in the forest, the mermaids live in the water, while the manitors live in the man cave. At which point, he introduces himself as Hutspar, which is, you know, he's this big bull thing, but he properly introduces himself as Hutspar. At which point, he introduces the Dipper to the other manitors, and the other manitors, of course, are not really sure what to make of Dipper at first. Dipper, of course, after introducing everybody, they all ask Dipper what his name is, and all of the manitor's names are just, you know, based on various, you know, types of quote unquote manly things and puberty like things. For example, there's a guy called Pituitar, you know, those kinds of names. Because according to Alex, he made them up in like 1 minute. Because, you know, he didn't have time to give them all proper names. Just Shuts Hutspar. But of course, Dipper does proceed to reveal himself as Dipper, the quote-unquote destructor, Hutspar then proceeds to bring a proposal to the rest of the manitors about how they need to train, how he wants to learn the ways of their manliness and if they can help him out. Of course, they immediately reconvene and immediately respond that they can't, that after a brief introduction where they start wrestling each other and start punching each other randomly for no other reason, for being hyper aggressive. Kind of a stuff. And Thibberg, of course, responds that he likes these guys. After a brief, you know, interlude of that, they then respond that Dipper is not worthy of their secrets and that they're not going to train him. But of course, Dipper then proceeds to not really take no for an answer and decides to give them a really, you know, kind of claim that he understands, but also points out that they maybe aren't man enough to do it. Which, of course, causes Hutspar to kind of point out that you really shouldn't be saying stuff like that. But, of course, one of the Manitars is obviously more peeved off than the others and immediately confronts Dipper on the fact that he's not man enough. But also kind of proves Dipper's point because, in the process, he lists that he has multiple Y chromosomes, Adam's apples, and a whole bunch of other things where he claims he's a bigger, even more a man than anybody else. But all of the things he lists, what actually causes testosterone deficiency, which it kind of proves Dipper's point that he's not quote unquote man enough. But of course, Dipper points out that, you know, maybe he's not man enough, and then also makes a barking noise to kind of, you know, reference the fact that they're all a bunch of chickens. Which, of course, is a really clever way of doing the gag. They do a really clever thing with it. But ultimately, after reconvening and realizing that Dipper is trying to manipulate them into doing what they're doing, into doing what he wants them to do, and not fully understanding that that's what he's doing, they ultimately reconvene and decide that, yeah, they are going to train Dipper in the ways of their manliness. At which point, they introduce the first trial that Dipper needs to do, which is the pain hole. Something that apparently they tried to cut. There's a couple of gags like that, but this is something that they apparently tried to cut, and the only reason it's here is because it's so vague. Like, that's literally the only reason it's here. But of course, like, there's something, the censors really pointed out that there's definitely something wrong, and they couldn't quite place their finger on it, but because it was so vague, they, you know, kept the joke. But of course, they introduced Dipper to the pain hole, which is, you know, the idea is that they need to train in their... And then they need to hone their sense of fear and conquer their fear, and that's why the pain hole exists. It literally just causes pain if you stick your hand into it. So, of course, Dipper is nervous about it, and after seeing, you know, one of the Manitars do it and obviously fail, but,
Hello.
Okay.
Alright. Okay. Alright,
I guess.
Alright. I'll send her my number then. I'll send her my time then.
I haven't sent my time then because I didn't do that. I scheduled my Uber and just didn't do that.
Okay. Alright. Bye.
But in any case, Dipper is, of course, nervous about the idea of, you know, sticking his hand in the pain hole because he saw a Manitar do it and obviously was in very visible physical pain. But he forces himself to do it after being pushed by Hutspar, pointing out that he won't be a man if he doesn't. So, he does stick his hand in and lets out a very, you know, girly scream, because Dipper is obviously not traditionally manly yet, but he puts it, he lets out a girly scream. Meanwhile, Mabel is currently trying to give Stan a makeover. First things first, he tries to work on Stan by, you know, having Seuss dress up as Lazy Susan, with Lazy Susan say, with Seuss says he's soft like a woman, but she then proceeds to kind of telling Stan to just kind of be himself while she goes off to, you know, kind of silently, you know, record his progress and judge his every move. So, of course, Stan immediately walks over to quote-unquote Lazy Susan and asks if he can borrow $5, which, of course, Mabel points out is wrong. So, of course, she points out that, you know, he can't just do that. So, she's pointing out that he needs a lot more work than she realized. I mean, it's at this point where, you know, she then proceeds to start trying to figure out that, hey, she needs to kind of make sure Stan is kind of in more physically attractive and all these other things. So, and of course, tries to get him to kind of learn him, but quickly discovers that he is kind of a piece of work, and that it's going to take a long montage to actually fix him. So she puts on some montage music, at which point we see an introduced montage of Dipper and Mabel going on their various quests. Obviously, Dipper's is more, you know, traditionally, you know, trying to conquer trials to actually become a more traditionally masculine. While Mabel is trying to fix Scrunkle Stan. And there's a lot of really fun visual gags in this, as well as just the lyrics being complete nonsense. I do kind of like quite a bit, but it's a really funny sequence. But ultimately, after the sequence is over, Dipper of course points out that he was skeptical at first about the Mantars, but does point out that he does feel like he has grown quite a bit to the point where, you know, he can actually feel comfortable around the Mantars and about how, you know, about their lifestyle and those kinds of things. But of course, Hutspar points out that it's not over yet and that there's still one other trial, with Dipper pointing out that he's already conquered the other 49 they've put in front of him, which points out that whatever it is, he can handle it. At which point, Hutspar proceeds to escort him, you know, out of the quote-unquote bathhouse of the building, which is just a series of geysers that all the Mantars hang out in. But they proceed to escort him off to the main antechamber of their little cave, and covers him head to toe in temporary tattoos. So, you know, kind of signifying that yes, he is in fact going to be a man after this. But he then proceeds to introduce Dipper to their leader. They then introduce this old man Manitar who comes in, with Dipper wondering if he's the oldest or wisest. But as it turns out, the old man is not their leader, and in fact, Leader-R is what you'd expect from a leader of a very manly race of Minotaur people. He's just this big, bulky dude with a massive loincloth made out of smaller loincloths. And, of course, Leader-R proceeds to ask Dipper if he truly wants to become a man, and proceeds to tell him that in order to do that, he needs a particular final trial. At which point, he reaches into his chest and pulls out a massive spear, which he then places and plops at Dipper's feet. It's covered in not quite blood, because apparently they were like a little inconsistent with whether or not blood was allowed in the show. But he drops it at Dipper's feet and tells him that to take the spear and kill the multi-bearer and bring out back his head. Which of course Dipper is not really sure what a multi-bearer is, but he then proceeds to point out that he is their sworn enemy, and that, you know, they have been feuding with him for a long time, and that if Dipper wants to prove himself manly and prove that he's mastered their ways, that he needs to bring back conquer the multi-bearer. This of course causes Dipper to become a little bit nervous because he's not entirely sure what they mean, because he's not entirely comfortable with what they mean by conquer. But then Hutspar goes through Dipper's bag and reveals that he actually does have his Baba CD on him. And of course Dipper just kind of plays it off as that it's not his and hides it behind his back. Just disappears after this point. He doesn't insist that it's nothing, it's not his, he's holding it for a friend. The other Mantars start to become nervous about the idea that, you know, Dipper may not be up to the task, but ultimately, Dipper declares that he will indeed conquer the Multi-Bear. At which point he goes off on this long quest to find the tallest peak in Gravity Falls, which is where the Multi-Bear actually resides. So, he goes through the Oregon, he's climbing through the Oregon mountain ranges, trying to find this mythical beast. And eventually, he does arrive at the multi-bear's cave, which, of course, Dipper's not entirely sure what a multi-bear is, at which point he meets the multi-bear, which is this massive monstrosity made out of, you know, multiple bears, as the name implies. But Dipper, of course, is nervous because, you know, he has no idea what he's supposed to do. But the multi-bear confronts him, and the main head speaks, and he's voiced by Alfred Molina, which is great. But the multi-bear speaks and asks him why he's come there, and Dipper responds that he's come seeking his head. Or rather, just one of them, because, you know, he has like 7 or 8. But of course, the multi-bear points out that this is foolish and they should just leave now while he has the chance. But Dipper doesn't back down, at which point the multi-bear declares, so be it, and they get into a confrontation. And the fight is actually pretty good. So, like, Dipper kind of holds his own against the multi-bear and eventually is able to sneak around it. And does wind up choking it out with the spear, so it goes down. At which point he declares that a man shows no mercy and is standing over the multi-bear ready to deliver a kill. But the multi-bear ultimately accepts his fate but then tells Dipper that he just has one request, which is that he wants to die listening to his favorite song. Dipper, of course, responds that he's more than happy to do that, at which point he walks over to the tape deck that the multi-bear has, and it's revealed that they have the exact same taste in music. And it's revealed that they both like Atlantis pop group BABA, specifically their hit song Disco Girl, and of course they kind of bond over it when they realize that they both know all the words, and they both find the song catchy. And of course, it's revealed that the reason the multi-bear and the Manichars are sworn enemies is because they constantly make fun of him for liking the song and knowing all of the words. Which, of course, Dipper totally gets and understands, but then realizes now that he's actually made a friend, that now he kind of has to kill the multi-bear, which he's not really enthused about. But the multi-bear kind of accepts his fate, pointing out that, you know, Dipper's manliness and actually properly becoming a man is more important. But Dipper ultimately decides not to do it, and then returns to the Manichar cave with the spear and tells him that he's not going to kill the multi-bear, which of course causes everyone in the cave to become upset with him. And of course Dipper then points out that, you know, he's not going to do it because of this horrible thing that he doesn't frankly want to do. And he goes on to kind of give this impassioned speech about how he understanding that the Manichar's way of being men is wrong. He points out that, you know, it's about overcoming trials and improving your manliness and a whole bunch of other things, but he's realizing that's all a bunch of nonsense. And points out that, you know, he admits he's not traditionally masculine, of course. He admits that, you know, he doesn't have chest hair, and sometimes there's a popular, catchy pop song on the radio that he leaves on, pointing out that, you know, they're in the top 40 for a reason. And of course, this causes Hutzbar, who kind of has been Dipper's friend throughout all of this, to ask Dipper what he's saying. But Dipper then proceeds to just respond that having met the multi-bear, he understands he's a really cool guy and that they're kind of jerks for wanting to cut off his head. This, of course, causes Leaderar to blow up at him and insist that Dipper needs to kill the multi-bear or never become a man. But Dipper holds his ground and insists that if that's what it takes to become a man, then he will never become a man. But of course, the Manichars are kind of upset at him for kind of abandoning their teachings, but ultimately aren't that upset about it because they immediately just go off to go do, you know, more manly things. While Dipper kind of just leaves the cave, realizing they're not as cool as he thought they were. At which point, this cuts back to Mabel and Stan, where Mabel is, of course, still trying to get Stan to be, you know, a better version of himself, and discovers that she's failed completely miserably. At which point, Wendy points out that, you know, it's not her fault, pointing out that Stan is kind of just unfixable, like the pizza like the pie trolley in the diner, which gives Mabel an idea, and immediately tells Stan to, you know, come with her and leave his pants at home, which of course she responds that he's more than happy to do. At which point, they march over to Greasy's diner, And she proceeds to go and tell Lazy Susan that she knows that she likes fixing things, and remarks that her uncle's a piece of work, and that she will most likely have a lot of fun trying to fix him, and also makes a joke about how, you know, women's life expectancy is longer than men, and that she needs to know her dating pool and slower her standards. But of course, it's seemingly at first, Lazy Susan just kind of leaves, not really interested in the idea of, you know, dating Stan. But then she comes back with her number, and then also offers him some pie on the house. Telling Stan to call her sometime. At which point she goes back to work, and Stan is overjoyed about the fact that he, you know, was successfully able to get Lazy Susan's phone number with Mabel's help, and they do have a moment where, you know, Stan does thank her, but of course Mabel then immediately goes off the rails about, you know, trying to do a whole bunch of other things now that they've successfully, you know, gotten Lazy Susan to date Stan. But Stan just responds that he's okay for now, and that he just wants to enjoy his pie in peace, kind of just enjoying his victory. But it's at this point where Mabel sees Dipper, and Mabel is very excited to see Dipper. Like, she's just kind of like, hey, you see me? You see me in the window? Hi, I'm calling your name. It's a really funny, really cute little interaction. I love it. Dipper, of course, walks in, and he sits down, and Stan, of course, Stan and Mabel both see the long face. Stan, of course, isn't really interested in hearing it of Dipper at first, and if Dipper wants to talk about it, but Dipper opens up anyway, and proceeds to explain that he was with the Manitars, and that ultimately they wanted him to do this really awful thing that he couldn't bring himself to do, and so he ultimately had to just leave them and never come back. And of course, Stan, like, even though he isn't initially interested in Dipper's problems, does point out that he's proud of Dipper because he stood his ground and decided to be his own man. Which of course he points out he feels like is manly in its own way. But of course responds that, you know, what does he know? This of course causes Dipper to become very happy, at which point Mabel notices that he finally has his first chest hair. You know, a sign that, you know, the lesson has indeed stuck. And is in fact, you know, coming full circle. But it's at this point where, you know, she then proceeds to pluck out the chest hair to put in her scrapbook, which is an established thing that comes up in this episode. It's established that, you know, she started making a scrapbook, she started putting pictures of it in it, and that winds up being important for way later. But of course, at this point where Dipper is, of course, dejected, of course, distraught over the idea of losing his first chest hair, but Stan reassures him, pointing out if he's anything like his uncle, there's plenty more where that came from. At which point, he whips off his shirt to reveal he's just head to toe in hair. Which, of course, they jokingly remark is gross, but then more seriously responds that, no, seriously, that's disgusting, put your shirt back on. And then the episode ends with the ending sequence. Where it is revealed that, you know, despite his victory of getting Lazy Susan to date him and give him her number, he's quickly discovering that was a mistake, because he's finding out that she is really clingy and also is constantly trying to introduce him to her cats. So he starts to wonder, maybe this was a mistake, and now I need to figure out how to get out of this. So, yeah, it's a fun little bit of character development for Stan that gets quickly derailed by the fact that, you know, Lazy Susan is way too clingy for him, and he's realizing that it was a mistake to try and date her. But also, kind of more importantly, the A episode is definitely about, you know, toxic masculinity. And it's also a really fun little conclusion to the story, because this is kind of something that Alex fought with a lot when he was creating the series, but when a lot of people were designing Stan, they kind of brought him back as, you know, old and emaciated and like, you know, old, scrawny, kind of, having declining health. And obviously, Alex kind of stuck with that to get the current design of Stan, which is, you know, beefy, big shoulders, lots of chest hair, you know, one of those kinds of designs. And that's something that Alex mentions is kind of an important, that brings this episode home a lot, and something I kind of agree with, which is that, you know, when you look at, like, Dipper and Stan's relationship, Stan is very much the type of man that Dipper wants to be, at least physically. Like, when you look at Stan, he's obviously, you know, this very obviously big, beefy, tough man, despite his old age, he's still very much, you know, built like a brick shithouse. But And of course, Dipper does kind of admire him and wants to be, and at least physically, Stan is the kind of person he wants to be. Obviously, he would never admit it because everything else about Stan is kind of a hot mess. But like he is touched by Stan saying that, you know, you're your own man and I'm proud of you, because, you know, he does kind of want to be Stan in his own way. So it is kind of a little touching that Stan is the one of all people to say that to him at the end. Like that, which helps to hammer the lesson home. Which, of course, this episode is a really good idea of toxic masculinity. And obviously, the point about the episode is that they introduce the Minotaurs, and it makes a very big point that you don't want to be like them. They are obviously constantly causing fights for little to no reason. They obviously are just constantly doing bullying people. They kind of haze another magical creature. For not being their idea of manly. Like, he likes to listen to catchy pop songs, and they're like, that's not manly, you need to knock that off. Even though, you know, it's not that big a deal. They're just jerks. But, you know, it does kind of reinforce the idea that you shouldn't be like the Minotaurs. And I do kind of like that. It's a really good episode. And I feel like it holds up really well, even though Alex had some trepidations about it when he was making it, and a little bit afterward when he aired it. So it is it ultimately is a good episode. I do kind of like it, and I can't see why Alex would dislike it at the time, but now that he kind of has mellowed on that a little bit, I can kind of see, like, yeah, this is a really good episode that holds up really well, and I do kind of like that. But in case, that is going to do it for this episode. What did you guys think? Let's get a discussion going in the comment section down below, or over on my Discord server, link is in the description. But in any case, thank you guys so much for watching. If you enjoyed, please remember to like, comment, and subscribe, especially since we are going to be doing Gravity Falls for the entire month of October. So if you absolutely are not subscribed yet and want to see more of what we're covering and all those other things, I highly recommend doing that. Please do so. Also be sure to go and check out my Twitch, because we are streaming games Saturdays, every Saturday and Sunday for the month as well, a different game every day. So if you absolutely want to check that out, again, you can watch them on YouTube, but Twitch helps me, following me on Twitch helps support me, because it gets me one step closer to being able to go full time, which I appreciate that, because it'll enable me to go for Twitch affiliate, so please go do that. And also, of course, be sure to check out the Discord, because in addition to having a Minecraft server over there now that you guys can play and hang out in, which I recommend checking out, we also are going to be watching The Great Gatsby at the end of the month to tie into Gravity Falls month. If you don't understand the reference, read the book of Bill. And finally, if you want to see more content from me, then be sure to check out the playlist linked in the end screen. The top playlist is the first of these that I did, which was Courage Month. It is still a very popular series that I have done. So if you absolutely have not seen that one yet, be sure to go check that out. Well, the previous one of these I did was Danny Phantom Month. If you did not check that one out yet either, please go sure to check that one in the bottom playlist. And finally, you know, check out Twitter for updates and other things. But in any case, thank you guys so much for watching. Until next time, we'll see you guys in the next video. Peace.